Item number 532. I'm pressing on the upward way, higher ground, in number 532.
Thank you. If you want to pray for them.
Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this time. I want to thank you for these people. I want to thank you for it, this world that you've made for us. I want you to bless us, watch over us, and bless this sermon that you gave us. And I want you to, and we want to thank you for the great miracles that you've done and the miracles that Jesus done. And we know that you've sent Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Tonight, we're going to use our corporate time of prayer for something special. Not that it's not always special, but we've got an important ministry opportunity coming up in the life of our church. We've got a wild game supper coming up. It's a very important outreach in the life of our church, and we want to be able to bathe that ministry opportunity in prayer. Why do we pray as a church? Why do we do that? Because there's power. When believers come together in harmony, in unity, and seek the Lord's face about something, God answers in a mighty way. So what we're going to do tonight, we're going to come together as a church in unity, in harmony, in peace. And we're going to seek the Lord that He would bless the wild game supper. Here's a few issues that I want to call to your attention surrounding that ministry opportunity for us to be praying about tonight. First, we want to pray for Brother James Guthrie. He's going to be bringing the message. We want to ask that the Holy Spirit would give him the right message, anoint him, and give him power and conviction as he proclaims it. We also want to pray for the various volunteers. There's a lot of volunteers who are going to be giving of their time and of their energy. There's going to be volunteers involved with meal preparation. There's going to be volunteers involved with child care. There's going to be volunteers involved with outreach. There's going to be volunteers involved with decorating. So many volunteers. We want to ask God to bless them and help them to accomplish the tasks that they need to do this week. We also want to pray for the attendees. Folks, this Saturday is going to be a series of divine appointments. Folks are going to be there. Folks who are not in church, folks who've never attended church, and it's not by accident. God has brought them there by His providence. We want to pray for the lost who are going to be attending. The Holy Spirit might move and bring conviction that they might respond by receiving Jesus. We also want to pray for the backslidden. Just on the basis of numbers, we can say that there's going to be a lot of backslidden Christians in attendance. Those who know Jesus, but they're not in good standing with Him. They're out of fellowship. We want to pray that God would use this event to show them, to bring them back home, that they might rededicate. We also want to pray about the follow-up. When the meal is over, when that ministry opportunity ends on Saturday, it's still not over with. Those who have signed some kind of decision cards, I try and go with others and do follow-up. As I do that, there's three things that I want you to pray about. If there's anybody who trusts Jesus, when we go and talk to them, that we could give them assurance about their decision, that we could help get things clear with them. We also want to pray that they would follow up their salvation with baptism. And then we want to pray that they would be planted in a Bible-believing church. Evangelism does not end until that person is a member and in good standing with a Bible-believing church so that they can be disciples, so that they can grow and thrive in the Lord. So we want to pray about all of those things tonight surrounding the Wild Game Supper. So if you will, make your way to the front. And let's have this time of prayer. Thank you. Heavenly Father, at this time we come into your presence, Lord. And as we do, we offer to you the sacrifice of praise, Lord. We worship you. We honor you because you alone are worthy of our worship and our honor. Lord, as we think of you, your many ways and your goodness towards us, we want to thank you for Jesus. He is the epitome of your goodness, of your love to us. Where would we be without Christ? We would be a people without hope. We would be a people on our way to hell. We would be a people estranged from you. And yet through Christ, all the promises of you are yea and amen in Jesus. We have a relationship with you, strength and life, hope for eternity, made possible through the shed blood of Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Father, with our salvation also comes a calling to serve. Lord, you know how to build your kingdom. And your sovereignty, you could have chosen any way in which to do it. And yet, Father, in accordance to your sovereign will, you have chosen to use us. We are the hands, the feet of Christ who carry on his ministry. And Lord, this Saturday, we will be carrying on the ministry of Jesus in this Wild Game Supper. Lord, we ask that you would bless and guide every aspect of it. Father, I pray for Brother James right now. I pray, Father, that you would prepare the message for the man and the man for the message. Give him the words to say and to speak, Lord. And Father, I pray that they would go forth with the power, conviction, and clarity of your Holy Spirit. Bless his message, Lord. Father, I also pray for the various volunteers, Lord. Lord, thank you for their willingness to give of their time and of their talents. Father, I pray for those preparing meals. I pray for those doing child care. I pray for those in outreach. I pray for those in decorating. Every single person, Lord, involved. Bless them, Lord. Help them to serve you. Lord, we also together pray for the attendees. Folks will be here, Lord, and it is not by accident. It is a divine appointment, Lord. Father, we pray for those who are going to be attending who are lost. Father, I pray that even now that you would begin to soften their hearts, that you would open them up, make them sensitive, Lord, to the spiritual things of you, so that when the time comes as the Holy Spirit moves in the preaching of your word, that they would be ready, that they might respond, Father. Lord, we pray that our Wild Game Supper would bring in a harvest for Jesus Christ. Lord, we also pray for those who are backslidden, Lord. There's going to be some there. They know you as Savior, but Lord, they're out of fellowship. They're not in church, Lord. They're not following you as they should in their lives. Lord, I pray that you would work in this ministry opportunity, Father, just to bring them back home, Lord. Bring them to that place of rededication, Father, and renewal. Lord, I also want to pray about the follow-up that this church will conduct, Lord. Father, as I and others, as we go and we speak to those who've made a decision for Christ, help us, Lord, to share from your word and to give them assurance of their standing. Lord, I pray for those who have made a decision for Jesus, who are saved, that they might follow that up with believers' baptism, and that, Lord, we could get them planted in a Bible-believing church, Lord, where they could grow, where they could serve, where they could be discipled, Father, in you. Lord, we offer this Wild Game Supper up to you as an offering, as a sacrifice, Lord. Use it for your glory, and may you be honored and pleased with it. And I ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
Those of you seated, let's stand up while the others come back, and we'll sing that great old song, How Great Thou Art, hymn number 6.
I'm
In 1931, there were a lot of buildings constructed in the United States of America. I don't know how many, probably tens of thousands, but there was one building that stood out that was constructed in 1931. It was over 100 stories tall. It cost over $40 million in 1931 dollars. To put that in perspective, that's $215 million in today's money. We know it as the Empire State Building. The Empire State Building reigned for 40 years as the tallest building on the face of the earth. But I want you to understand something about the Empire State Building. It was more than a building. It took on a whole life of its own. Do you know what it epitomized? The power of the United States of America. The 20th century has been called the century of America, the century of the United States, and that building epitomizes the power, the military, economic, political power of the United States of America. It's more than just a building. Well, tonight I want to talk to you about another structure, another building that symbolizes something else. It's a whole lot more than just some concrete. I want to talk to you tonight about the Tower of Babel, or as I call it, Satan's skyscraper. The Tower of Babel is more than a building. It's more than a tower. Do you know what the Tower of Babel is? It is a sin construct. It shows you what happens when unbridled sin takes hold of a people, takes hold in the life of an individual. You know what happens when sin takes hold? The judgment of God comes. Tonight I want to talk with you about Satan's skyscraper. We're going to see the rise and the fall of the Tower of Babel. If you brought your Bible tonight, I'm going to ask that you would open it to Genesis chapter 10. We're going to read the passage that I preached on last Sunday night, because this sets the stage for the building of this tower. We're going to look at Genesis 10, verses 8 to 10, and then we're going to look at Genesis 11, verses 1 to 9. So follow along as I read from God's Word. Beginning in verse 8 of chapter 10, it says, "Now Cush became the father of Nimrod. He became a mighty one on the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Therefore, it is said, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. The beginning of his kingdom was Babel and Erech and Akkad and Calneh in the land of Shinar." Now turn over one chapter to 11 and look at verses 1 to 9. "Now the whole earth used the same language and the same words. It came about as they journeyed east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. They said to one another, 'Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly.' And they used brick for stone, and they used tar for mortar. They said, 'Come, let us build for ourselves a city and a tower whose top will reach into heaven. And let us make for ourselves a name. Otherwise, we will be scattered abroad over the face of the earth.' The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. The Lord said, 'Behold, they are one people, and they have all the same language, and this is what they began to do, and now nothing which they purpose to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language so that they will not understand one another's speech.' So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of the whole earth, and they stopped building the city. Therefore its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole earth. And from there, the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of the whole earth." May God add his blessing to the reading of his inspired word. Let's pray together now. Heavenly Father, again we come into your presence, and as we do, as we study the Tower of Babel, we're seeing more than a tower, more than a building. We see the consequences of unbridled sin. Lord, the Tower of Babel took place at a certain time in history. But Lord, we know that within our hearts, within our lives, we are capable of such rebellion. We are capable of trying to usurp your rightful place of authority in our lives. Father, tonight, if there be someone here who is in rebellion, if there be someone here by their sin who's constructing their own tower against you, Lord, I pray that the Holy Spirit might bring conviction to their lives and that they would respond in conviction with repentance and a return to you, Father. Lord God, as I proclaim your word tonight, I ask that you would anoint me with your Holy Spirit, that you would give me the words to say and to speak, Lord, and these words would have power and clarity, Father, from you. Bless this message now. Use it to your glory. And I ask this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. In the book of Genesis, there's several cycles. You know how your washer has a rinse cycle? In Genesis, there are sin cycles. And you see them repeated over and over again in the earlier chapters of the book of Genesis. You'll see the following things take place. The Lord will set parameters. He will set parameters and boundaries. He will say, this is what I'm telling you to do. This is what you should not do. There's the boundary. Don't cross it. And if God's people would live within that boundary, there would be peace, there'd be safety, and there would be fellowship with God. But what we would see happen over and over again because of the sin nature and because of the tempter, what would happen? Mankind would step over that boundary. They would transgress. They would break God's law. God would warn them to repent, warn them to turn. Inevitably, many of them would not. So consequences would be brought to bear. We see that happen over and over again. We see it in Genesis 3 with Adam and Eve. We see it in the time of Noah when society rebelled against God and there was a flood. And we see it tonight in the building of the Tower of Babel, that sin cycle. Continue. Tonight, I want us to look at Satan's skyscraper. I want us to see how it rose, and I want us to see how it fell. And I want us to see that for a particular reason. The tower is not just a building. It's not just concrete. It's not just blocks. I don't want you to think of it like that. The tower epitomizes rebellion and sin. On that basis, we can say all of us are capable of building our own Tower of Babel. All of us are capable of that rebellion that raises a fist to God and says, I will have it my way and not yours. Let me tell you how these towers come up, and let me tell you how they fall. Two components to that that I want you to see tonight. First, the first component, I want you to see what I call Satan's building blocks. Satan's building blocks. How did this tower come up? Now, I want you to think about any type of construction project, maybe building a home, building a shop, whatever you might have. You bring in various items, do you not? You bring them together, and they all come together in order to form that structure, in order to form and complete that project. This tower was not unlike that. Satan brought several building blocks together among humanity at that time that caused them and led them to build this sinful construct. What were these building blocks? I want to share three of them with you. I want you to go back to Genesis 10. Genesis 10, and look at verses 8 to 10 again. Now, this concerns the founder of Babel. And according to Josephus, the ancient Jewish historian, he said that the people started to build the Tower of Babel on the advice of this man, on the advice of Nimrod. I want you to look at his character. He's the first world dictator with the first world empire. And I want you to note his character with me. And as you look at that, you'll see how it affected the people and some of the building blocks that caused them to build this tower. Look at verses 8 to 10 again. Now, Cush became the father of Nimrod. He became a mighty one on the earth. That means he was a leader, like a chieftain, a dictator. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Therefore, it is said, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. It means that his name was synonymous with hunting, so much so that it became a proverbial saying. Then we're told in verse 10, the beginning of his kingdom was Babel and Erech and Akkad and Kelnai and the land of Shinar. Looking at that passage and then another in chapter 11, we see the building blocks for this dark construct of rebellion. What were they? Well, number one was a faulty worldview. Faulty worldview. Now, what is a worldview? Worldview is how you and I interpret life. Did you know that you have a way of interpreting life? You have a set of beliefs that govern your life, that dictate how you view things, the decisions you make, what you do and what you don't do. All that comes together to form what we call a worldview. We see in the character of Nimrod that he had a faulty worldview, and he passed that worldview on to his subjects. It trickled down from the leadership, and it was passed on to his subjects in the kingdom of Babel. I want you to note with me in verses 8 to 10, just his name. What does his name mean? You remember from last Sunday, what did Nimrod's name mean? Rebel. That's right. He was a rebel. In the context of its usage, it means somebody who is defiant, who is set against God. We can see that he was personally a rebel. We can also see that he led his people in rebellion. The name of the capital of his empire was Babel. The place where the Tower of Babel was built was where? Babel. What does Babel mean? Well, we know that it came to mean in chapter 11, it came to mean confusion. But in the original Hebrew there in chapter 10, Babel meant gate of God. But that's God with a little g. It became a center for idolatry. What does that tell us? That worldview of rebellion, that worldview of defiance, it came from the leadership, it came from Nimrod, and it trickled down to the people, and it found expression in building that tower. Folks, we have to be so careful with this because many of us can adopt that same worldview. What kind of worldview did Nimrod have? He had a worldview that wanted to deify self rather than submit to the authority of God. He wanted it his way. The people wanted it their way. They wanted to knock God off his throne, and usurp his place as if they could do that. And it still happens today. If we're honest with ourselves, all of us have those moments, do we not? When we want things our way. When we don't want to submit to the authority of God. I'll give you an example about that. Somebody sent me, I guess they've got a sense of humor, they sent me an article on Aretha Franklin. Sent me an article on Aretha Franklin, and it had her top 10 diva-ish moments. Her top 10 diva-ish moments. And number one on that list was a concert that she did in Miami, Florida. And it says that she didn't like the temperature of the building. And in mid-sentence of a song, she screamed into the microphone that somebody need to turn the air conditioning on because it was too hot in there for her to sing. Well, apparently, it didn't get cold enough quick enough, so she screams into the microphone, getting mid-sentence in a song. It's not cold enough. Finally, you know what she did? She threw the microphone down and she walked off stage, ruining the concert for everybody else. Aren't we like that sometimes? We want things our way. We will not submit to the authority of God. Be very, very careful. Those instances will formulate a worldview. And that worldview will find expression in actions of our lives. And when you commit sinful actions, when you try and usurp the place of God, he will discipline, will he not? He will judge. That's how the Tower of Babel came to be. Look at another building block. Not only do we see a faulty worldview, but there was foolish pride. There was foolish pride. Go back and look at verses 8 and 10 of chapter 10. The writer here makes a statement about Nimrod. He makes a statement two times. It says in verse 9, he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. He goes on to say it had become a proverbial saying. It was so well known about Nimrod. He says, therefore it is said, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. Now, what's the writer talking about there? Nimrod was a hunter, but he wasn't a deer hunter. He wasn't a duck hunter. He wasn't a squirrel hunter. He was a man hunter. He was a homicidal psychopath, if you will, cruel dictator. He killed people, killed them on a whim. He wasn't ashamed about his actions. He wasn't embarrassed. We're told that he flaunted it in the face of God. Nimrod, a mighty hunter
before God. That shows his foolish pride. He wasn't ashamed of his sin. He wasn't embarrassed. He flaunted it in the face of God. And he led his people to do the same thing. How odd does it sound for a people to build a tower, to reach into heaven, to think that they could usurp the place of God? Is that not foolish? Does that not smack of arrogance and pride? They learned it from their king. They learned it from their dictator, Nimrod. Folks, we should not boast about anyone or anything except our Savior, Jesus Christ. I think of the old hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." One of the verses of that hymn says, "Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my God." We should not boast about our achievements. We should boast in the finished work of Jesus Christ. He is the only one we should boast in. He is the only one that we should take pride in. To have that foolish pride in the face of God, if it were not so despicable, it would be funny, wouldn't it? Having pride in yourself in the face of Almighty God, you know what it's like? It's like a man with a rubber life raft. Can y'all picture a rubber life raft? It's yellow. It's leaking. Can you picture that? Little dinghy leaking. It's sinking. And this person is boasting about it. "Look at my mighty ship. Look what I have. Look at this mighty specimen of a ship." And he's boasting to a multi-billionaire who owns a 100-foot yacht with a swimming pool and a helicopter landing pad on it. How ridiculous would that be? That's what it's like when mankind boasts about their achievements in the face of Almighty God. It's pathetic. It'd be funny if it wasn't so sorry and despicable on our part. That faulty worldview, that foolish pride within the mind and within the heart, it found expression in life. We've seen two building blocks so far, that faulty worldview, that foolish pride. Now look at another building block. I call it focused rebellion. Look at chapter 11 now, verse 4. Chapter 11, verse 4. We've seen how the stage was set for the building of that tower. We've seen Nimrod and his empire, how they were defiant against God. And then now we see that defiance find expression. Look at verse 4, what they decided to do. They said, "Come, let us build for ourselves a city and a tower whose top will reach into heaven. And let us make for ourselves a name. Otherwise, we will be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth." You see, what was in their heart, what was in their mind, that arrogance, that rebellion, that pride, they found expression for it. Their rebellion was focused into an act, that tower. That tower is not a mere building. That tower is not simply a structure. That tower epitomizes rebellion against God and the judgment that it brings. Folks, do you realize what that means? The tower was a do-it-yourself project, if you will. Their rebellion, their pride came out in their lives, and it can happen to us. If you're arrogant in the face of God, if you're prideful, if in your life you do not submit to Him and recognize His authority, it's going to come out in what you do. Your faulty worldview will lay the foundation for your own Tower of Babel. Your pride, your arrogance, your defiance against God will begin its construction. But do you know what it will bring? The judgment of God against your life. Don't follow Satan's plan. Don't give in to a faulty worldview. Don't give in to your pride. Recognize your God. Submit to His authority. If you're going to boast, boast in the cross. Boast in the finished, completed work of Jesus. We've seen one component right now. We've seen Satan's building blocks in constructing the tower. Now let's look at a second component. I want to share with you God's wrecking ball. The Tower of Babel went up, but God brought it down. There is no structure on earth that cannot be destroyed. I Googled this week. I typed it in. I said, what is the largest structure, the largest building that's ever been taken down, that's ever been demolished? What came up in my search was a building in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. It's the Sears Merchandise Building. Let me tell you how big this was. 2.7 million square feet. Pretty big, isn't it? It was built from 1918 to 1919. 2,000 laborers worked for 1 year, 6 days a week, to build it. It was leveled in just a matter of moments by 12,000 pounds of high explosives. Leveled it. Gone. Parking lot. Something that had stood for decades, something that looked so strong, so sturdy. Gone. Just like that. Folks, our sinful constructs, our own towers of Babel, can be leveled in an instant by Almighty God. He did it then, and He'll do it now. Let me tell you the process of how He wrecked the Tower of Babel, how He destroyed it. There were some steps in this process. Number one, God surveyed. God surveyed. Look at verse 5 of Genesis chapter 11, verse 5. The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. Now, what does this mean? Does this mean that God was about His business of governing the universe? He wasn't paying attention to what was going on in Babel. Then all of a sudden, He said, oh my goodness. He came down and He looked and said, whoa, they're in the midst of rebellion. They're building a tower. Perhaps I need to do something about that. No. That's not what that means. That's not what happened. God was not taken by surprise. Nothing catches God unaware. We have a word for this attribute of God. It's called omniscience. Omniscience means that God knows everything. God never thinks. Did you know that? God never contemplates. God never thinks because He already knows. He knows past. He knows present. He knows future. He knows it and He sees it all. So how do you reconcile verse 5 with God's omniscience? Well, a lot of times in Scripture, God is spoken of in human terms. We call it an anthropomorphism. Don't ask me to spell it. I can't. Anthropomorphism, it means Scripture speaking about God in terms of a man on occasions. When it says that He went down, when it says there in verse 5, the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built, what it literally means in the Hebrew is that He came down, He saw with a view to take action. God's patience had run out. He had known the whole time what they were doing. He knew when the rebellion started within the heart because He knows what's in the heart of man. He knows our intentions. He knows our motivations. He knew it when it started in the heart and mind of sinful man. But His patience had run out. He surveyed with a view to take action. Folks, I'll have you know today that our God is still a surveying God. He looks at your heart. He looks at your mind. He looks at the actions of your life. And praise God, He's long-suffering, isn't He? He's patient. But there will come a time when God will come down to act. There will come a time when He judges, when He disciplines. Are you ready for that time? What can you do? What must you do in your rebellion? In your rebellion. And run to Jesus. Run to Christ. Let me talk to you about God's omniscience for a second. I want to share one more thing about that. How many of you believe that God sees everything, knows everything? Okay. How many of us live as if we believe that? Not raising my hand. God does see everything. God does know everything. That should govern the way in which we live and what we do. Think of it like this. How many of you have got kids? Some of you got kids. When you're around, when you're in the room, Your kids are going to be on their behavior, aren't they? They're going to be on their best behavior. They're going to do what you tell them to do. When you're away, what are they going to do? You hope they're going to mind. You hope they're going to do right. But if you're not there and they know it, what are they going to do many times? They're going to do what they want. It's different, isn't it, from when you're in the room and when you're not. Folks, there is never a time when our Heavenly Father is not in the room. There's never a time when He does not see. There is never a time when He does not know. So we should live accordingly, and that is in obedience to Him. So God has decided to destroy the Tower of Babel. He surveyed it. Then He sentenced. He sentenced. Look at verses 6 and 7. Then the Lord said, "Behold, they are one people, and they all have the same language. And this is what they began to do, and now nothing which they purpose to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us," reference to the Trinity, "let us go down and there confuse their language, so that they will not understand one another's speech." God surveyed with a view to take action. God sentenced. He said, "I've had enough. This rebellion's gone on long enough. It is time to do something about it." From what we can tell in our passage, the time of sentence to the time of judgment was very close together. In fact, it's probably almost instantaneous. Does God always work like that? Does He always sentence and then it's done? No. In accordance to His sovereign will, in accordance to His plan, there are instances when God sentences and does it immediately. However, there are other times when God sentences and His judgment is delayed, isn't it, by His perfect plan. He's got that perfect time and that perfect way in which it will be carried out. Many people think because the judgment of God is not immediate that it is not imminent, that it is not absolutely a certain fact that it will come. There are folks today that think that they've gotten away with their sin. They've gotten away with their rebellion. You may be one of them tonight. You may have sinned against God, done grievous things, and you may think, "I've gotten away. I've gotten by with it. Nothing has happened." It will. It will. His judgment is imminent. It will come. It will come. This week I was reading a newspaper, and it was talking about some of the problems that our prison system is having. One of the problems that we're having is actually carrying out executions. Have y'all read about this? It was like one company in the United States, one company in the world, that made this certain chemical that's used for a lethal injection to carry out executions. Now that company's gone, they can't get the chemical, and so there is a delay in carrying out executions. Now think of what's going on all throughout our prisons. Thousands of prisoners, they've been sentenced. They're on death row, but they are awaiting judgment. During that time, they're sheltered, they're clothed, they're fed. But judgment will come, will it not? The same is true for the sinner. You may think you've gotten away scot-free. You may think that you're fine. But the judgment will come. God never sentences without fulfilling it. What can you do? What must you do? You must run to Christ. You must go to Him. He is the only refuge against the judgment of God. So what did God do as He destroys Babel? He surveyed, He sentenced, then He scattered. Look at verses 8 and 9 of the passage. He fulfills His sentence. It says verse 8, "So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of the whole earth, and they stopped building the city. Therefore its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of the earth." The Lord surveyed what they had done. The Lord sentenced them. Then the Lord executed judgment. If you're like me, have you ever asked the question, why confuse their languages? Why scatter them? God is omnipotent. He's all powerful. He could have carried out the sentence, carried out judgment any way he wanted to. He could have killed them all, literally. Our God could have killed all of those people and remained totally holy and just in what he did. Why confuse the tongues? Why divide the races on the basis of culture and on the basis of language? Why was that the judgment of God? Because God is fulfilling his word. He'd given a command to the people. Stick your finger there in Genesis 11 and turn over to Genesis 9. Genesis 9, verse 1. God has already finished one judgment, the flood. He's preserved Noah and his family. And now that he's established a covenant with Noah, and he gives him a command in verse 1, a command to he and his family, but also the successive generations after him. He says, and God blessed Noah, his sons, and said to them, here's what God said, be fruitful and fill the earth. The word fill right there literally means to go all across the earth. God wanted all of the earth inhabited by his creation, by that creation which was made in his image. What were the people doing during the time of Babel? They were coming together for a sinful purpose. They weren't filling the earth. They were denying the command of God. So God, in carrying out his judgment, is fulfilling his word. Is that not amazing? And folks, this tells us something very, very important. God always fulfills his word. God's judgment is always in keeping with his word. What does he tell us today about the way he carries out consequences for sin? He tells us two things in his word that he will do. If you are a believer and you are in the midst of sin and you are in the midst of rebellion, he will do something called chastening. That means he will discipline you. Because you are a son, because you are a daughter, he will not tolerate rebellion. He will not tolerate you going off into sin and breaking his commands. He loves you too much to tolerate it. So what does he do? He brings discipline to bear upon your life. It really is an honor. It's a painful experience, but it is an honor. Because it is a sign of our salvation. It is a sign of our status as an adopted child through Jesus Christ. That's what he does to believers, and that's in keeping with his word in the book of Hebrews. What does he do if you're lost? If you're lost and you're a rebel, if you're lost and you have usurped the authority of God, what does he do? He judges. He doesn't discipline. He judges. And in the word of God, it says that the ultimate judgment for the sinner who has rejected Christ as a consequence of their life, wholly given over to sin, they will experience something called hell. That is separation from the love of God, and that is to experience in full force the wrath of God. How long will it last? Forever. Darkness, punishment, pain, forever. He said it in his word, so he will carry it out in life. We see that shown for us in the destruction of the Tower of Babel. The Lord judged in accordance to his word. He fulfilled his word as he judged. That means that he will do so today. If you are a believer and rebelling against God, he most certainly will discipline you. He most certainly will chasten you in keeping with his word. If you're a lost sinner, there will come a day when you will enter a sinner's hell. What is the answer for these two groups? The answer is to come to Jesus. If you are a believer in the midst of rebellion, you need to come to the Lord in repentance and rededication. If you're a lost sinner, then you need to come to the Lord the first time and receive his son Jesus as Lord and as Savior of your life. God will destroy your Babel. God will destroy that tower. There will come a day when God will end your defiance, when God will end your rebellion. You have two choices today. You can humble yourself before God, as the book of James tells us to do, or you can be humbled by God. You don't want the second one. I promise you. You do not want to be humbled by God. It will be awful. It will be painful. It will be hard. Humble yourself before the Lord so that in due time, He can exalt you. We're going to have a time of decision right now. Brother Terry is going to come. Miss Debbie is going to play. If you are a